Holiday Library. I'm Sarah Holiday, Library Events Coordinator, and I'm mostly standing here for two practical purposes, one grand and one trivial. The grand one is to note that your donations to our annual fund support events like this one, as well as the maintenance of our landmark building, and the continued growth and strength of our collections for readers of all ages. It's not too late to give in 2015 and be honored in our next annual report. Donor information is available at the circulation desk or from any staffer. We appreciate your support. My trivial task, I bet you can guess, to ask you to silence your cell phone. See how mine is turned off? Let's all be like me. We're very honored to have with us this evening authors and library members Lily Tuck and Molly Haskell. Molly Haskell is the author most recently of the memoir My Brother, My Sister, and the film study Frankly, My Dear, Gone with the Wind Revisited. You've also doubtless seen her reviews in the New York Times and many other publications. Lily Tuck has written not only The Double Life of Liliane, on which we'll concentrate tonight, but The News from Paraguay, winner of the 2004 National Book Award, and four previous novels. Please join me in welcoming Molly Haskell and Lily Tuck.
Figures in your past, and as you probably know from what you've read about the book, it's so minimalist prose, but it's really maximalist story because it's like four generations of family, and people that you barely knew or didn't know at all, and who didn't talk, and so you created these scenarios. Anyway, one was the grandfather, very distinguished intellectual, who died or fell from the train or somehow was killed, and nobody ever told you how. And the other was the film that some of you may know, the Kieslowski film, the La Double Vie de Véronique, The Double Life of Véronique. Mm-hmm. And that was Irene Jacko playing, she actually learned Polish to play a Polish Veronica and a French Véronique. So I knew that that was in your mind, but what part did that film play? Was it just the idea of the double life, or was it the film?
Actually, the film, The Double Life of Véronique, is absolutely one of my favorite films of all time. And I watched it again two nights ago. I think I watch it once a year at least.
A little louder?
A little louder.
Or closer to the bite, maybe?
I was saying that The Double Life of Véronique was my favorite film of all times, practically, and I watched it again nights ago. And again, was incredibly moved because it was so subtle. And the connection between the two women who are played by Irene Jacob is very, very subtle. And it's not at all about doppelgangers. It's not symbolic at all. But their connection is sort of one of empathy and based on just a few little details that they share in common. And then afterwards, I watched and heard, I have such a hard time pronouncing his name, Krzysztof Kieslowski, speak, and he said that the movie was about the difficulty of naming things, and of course I love that, and that's where my title came from, absolutely, yeah. And as far as my grandfather,
what is the double life? Does it also refer to your life in Europe and your life in this country?
That's how it sort of started
a little bit.
Yeah, that's my original idea about back and forth between my father who lived in Rome and my mother who lived in the United States. And I would spend the winters with my mother and stepfather and then go to Rome with my father who was a film producer. And the lives were very, very different. But then...
Talk a little bit about the background.
The background?
Well, of the family story that you...
I was gonna read a little bit from my book, but I was gonna give you a bit of background about me. And these are facts, nothing that I've invented or imagined. I was born in France. Both my parents were German. in 1939 when the war broke out. My father was interned in a camp by the French, not because he was Jewish, but because the French interned all Austrian and German men between the ages of 18 and 55, the way we interned the Japanese. But my father was very lucky because most of these people were sent back to Germany and to probable or certain death. But my father joined the French Foreign Legion. And this always makes me smile because my father was not the Beaujolais type at all. He was overweight and very, very nearsighted. He wore glasses that were as thick as Coke bottles. And yet he later wrote a memoir about his time during the war. And it sounded like his time in the Foreign Legion was one of the happiest times in his life. He was sent to Algeria, to a town called Magma, near the Spanish-Moroccan border. And there he met all sorts of disparate people, like the pastry chef at Maxime's and a convicted murderer. And although he never saw any battle, he claims that that was the time when he became a man, or felt that he was a man. Meantime, my mother and I were in Paris. I was one, so I don't remember anything, obviously. My mother and I and a nanny drove to Lisbon, and we took a ship to New York. Eventually, I mean, it took a while to get visas and everything. Everybody was trying to get out. And we had a visa for New York for 3 days. And my mother remembers going to the World's Fair and being very surprised at how affluent and carefree everybody seemed, obviously compared to people in Europe. And then from there we went to Lima, Peru, where we stayed for the duration of the war. Then we went back to Paris and we spent about a year and a half there, and then my parents got separated. And this is where I start reading when we come to America. In the fall of 1947, Liliane, who has just turned 8, and her mother leave France. Oh, my mother's name was Irène, which is French for Irene, but she insisted on being called Irène, not Irene. Her mother leave France on a converted troop ship operated by Moore McCormick Lines. There's still a severe shortage of liners. Only 13 are in transatlantic operation versus 73 before the war. And only 2, the Queen Mary and the America, of the 13 are luxury liners. The rest are substandard and provide low-cost transportation. The fares range from $167 to $190 for the women and a flat fee of $127 for the men. The passengers sleep in open troop quarters that hold more than 100 passengers each. The sleeping berths are arranged in tiers of 4. Each berth has a mattress, clean linen, a blanket, a towel, and a cake of soap. Arriving on board late, Irène and Liliane are unable to get berths on the same tier. The women already occupying the 3 others refuse to give up their space or to move. Liliane sleeps on an upper berth a few tiers away from Irène, who sleeps on the lowest berth on another tier. In the berth directly below Liliane, the woman has managed to snuggle in her 2 little dachshunds. The dachshunds whine restlessly during the night and keep Liliane awake. The overhead lights are kept on all day and all night, and they too keep her awake. Irène also can't sleep, and most nights she gets up at 3 or 4 in the morning to use the communal bathroom and to take a shower. At that hour, she has some privacy. Most of the passengers on board are displaced persons. Thus far, only 36,000 out of the near 1 million Eastern European displaced persons have been allowed entry into the United States. 14-year-old Vera, who was sent to a forced labor camp and whose parents were gassed, is one of them. She and Liliane play cards together. They play relentlessly all day, sitting cross-legged up on either Liliane's berth or on Vera's, also a top berth, without ever exchanging a single word. Liliane speaks only French and Spanish, and Vera only Czech. You'll get sick if you stay in the cabin all day, she adds. Also, Yvonne is not sure she likes for Liliane to spend so much time with Vera. Although not the girl's fault, Yvonne senses something feral and perverse about her. She imagines that Vera's experience of deprivation, you know, perhaps beatings and rape in the labor camp, will taint Yvonne. When Yvonne goes up on deck, the air is humid, the ocean is relatively calm, and a uniform gray. While she sits in a deck chair and reads her book, Les Malheurs de Sophie, Sophie's Misfortunes, by the Comtesse de Ségur, an account of the trifling misadventures of a little French girl who regularly disobeys her parents and suffers the consequences. A Hungarian boy, his arms flailing, jogs awkwardly around the deck past her. Like Vera, he's an orphan and a camp survivor. He looks to be about 15 or 16, and Liliane knows there's something wrong with him. Each time he runs by Liliane, he shouts something at her, and Liliane, pretending to be absorbed in her book, does not look up. He frightens her. As Liliane shuts her book and gets ready to leave, the Hungarian boy comes around once again, and as if guessing her intention, he stops and stands directly in front of Liliane's chair. Then, before Liliane can move or say anything, the Hungarian boy drops his pants. A heavy-set Polish woman sleeps in the berth directly above Johann's, and every night around midnight, a man tiptoes into the room from the men's quarters and climbs into her berth. To do so, he first steps on the edge of Johann's berth before he hoists himself up into the woman's berth. Then the two have sex. Above Yann's head, the berth shakes so violently, she's afraid it will collapse on top of her. After a few minutes, the shaking stops. Then, almost immediately, the man leaves. Again, he steps down on the edge of Yann's berth. One night, a second man comes shortly after the first one has left, and he, too, steps on the edge of Yann's berth before hoisting himself up into the Polish woman's berth. The voyage takes 8 long days. The ship was disgusting, Yvonne tells Gabby, her future husband, when finally they land in New York Harbor. A floating flop house, she says. Un bordel, a brothel, she adds in French.
Deadpan detachment. I think it makes it just very, very funny. And it's part of, I want you to talk about autofiction, but first I was going to say, the other night we were looking at Brooklyn. Some of you have probably seen that. And the passage over, and I said, is that what it was? I mean, your Brooklyn was like a luxury liner compared to.
Yeah, this was really a horrible.
And I said that you, because the girl goes downstairs to eat, nobody's there, of course, because they all know not to eat because they'll get seasick. I said, did you have a dining room like that with a long table? And you said you never even got down there. You didn't know.
I remember being sick for most of the voyage. I mean, not seasick. I was sick with something else. But it was pretty unpleasant. Yeah. And people were so mean and nasty. And like the woman with the dachshund, that's absolutely true. I mean, she just, nobody would give up their space at all. Yeah. It was bad.
And I love the character of Irene, and you always call her Irene. You never say mother. I mean, you say her mother, but you don't ever have a sort of mother. It's not a sort of chummy mother-daughter relationship. That's partly because of her, isn't it? Because you say she was the, there were two other sisters who were really interesting, and you'll maybe talk about them. One was in 10.
My mother had two sisters, and one of them ended up living in Tanzania or Tanganyika, and her husband, who was a displaced person as well, he was from Estonia, and they were both stateless. Otherwise, they would have been put in a camp by the British, I guess. But he ran a sisal plantation, and they lived there. And then my mother's other sister stayed in Germany during the war and saw their apartment in Berlin completely bombed out. And luckily, her parents had a chalet in Innsbruck, and so she lived there during the war. She became a doctor, a medical doctor, and eventually came to the United States. But both of these women were very brave, not getting visas and not really having that much any money, or and the one thing she had as an advantage was that she was incredibly beautiful, so I think that helped a lot.
Tell the story with at least being pulled over in New York.
Right. I mean, that's in the novel. My mother, I mean, her looks were compared to Greta Garbo and Marlene Dietrich, and she spoke with this and sort of in sort of not quite sure, a middle European accent, and she would never say really where she was from or how old she was. I mean, so she sort of kept that mystery. But one time she said she was stopped by a policeman because she was going the wrong way somewhere, and the policeman, and she was trying to get on to the Third Avenue Bridge, and the policeman stopped her, and he asked her, he said, "Are you Marlene Dietrich?" And my mother said, "No, if I was Marlene Dietrich, I wouldn't be trying to save 25 cents to go on the Third Avenue Bridge."
So we want to talk, you wrote an essay about auto fiction. I want you to sort of explain what that is, but I just want to read, there was this one wonderful, very, very long review of the book, and I don't have the key phrase that you like in it, somehow I didn't copy that, but I am going to read the what he wrote. His name is Malcolm Forbes. No, Malcolm. Doesn't sound like part of that Forbes, but who knows. Towards the end of the book, Liliane's professor, Paul DeMann, tells his seminar students that Marcel Proust's great work is meant to be autobiographical, and yet, quote, "it is impossible to tell what is fact and what is fiction." Tuck may well have heeded those words and set out decades later to blur the boundaries and genres in a literary treatment of her early life. Maybe Tuck's father was bailed out by Josephine Baker when he was stranded in France. Maybe Tuck did have a medical Aunt Barbara who was summoned to the White House to look at the blemishes on the First Lady's, that was Jackie's, face. And maybe Tuck did turn heads and break hearts and fly out to meet a pining boyfriend in Bangkok. After a fashion, we stop questioning how much of what we are reading is memoir and how much of it isn't, and simply surrender to the elegant, limpid prose of this, the most beguiling work of Lily Tuck's career. So, you wrote the essay on autofiction, and it's a French, it was originally, I mean, as Proust and earlier, it's existed since time, you know, since people have been writing practically.
Right, apparently the word autofiction was coined by somebody called Serge Dubrovsky in 1977 because he wrote a book, and I love this, the title in French is F-I-L-S, fils or fi, which means either son or thread, depending on how you pronounce it. And he was sort of a postmodern French writer, but clearly other people have been writing autofiction, Proust, Jean-Jacques Rousseau, Joyce, Wordsworth, and apparently even an 18th century BC Hesiod, Works and Days, is meant to be autofiction. So it really isn't anything that new. No.
Well, and one of the big influences, as you've said, is Sebald, W.D. Sebald. So talk about that a little bit.
Yeah. I mean, I've always loved Sebald, and I find his, I was looking up things about him, and one of the things he said was that that fiction should have sort of a ghost-like presence, which I think means that there's sort of a mystery, or that things aren't explained, or and things sort of remain inconclusive, which he certainly, certainly wrote that way. And also, I think Sebald gave me permission to digress, and I love going off on tangents and writing about the origin of something, or explaining about the aqueducts in Rome, or something that I think may or may not be relevant.
But they're wonderful little disquisitions, like on the German economy, very informative. I thought it was really very interesting. But there's no kind of warning that this is coming up. But, I mean, it's just sort of tucked in with everything else. It's just part of the same kind of mood and surprise. And I think that's always. And I don't quite understand. I think we are so much more, it's sort of humbling to know, there's this thing about how our memories, as we know now, are saying he was shocked to find, he uses the word, he didn't say the difference between fact and fiction, but life has been experienced or things that have been assimilated, in other words, that have been pulled in as part of your memories. And he wrote about two bombing experiences during the war in England, and his brother wrote and said, the first one you did see, the other one you couldn't if you weren't even born then. And he looked into it, and sure enough, he hadn't been born, but the other brother had written about it so vividly, he remembered all the details as if he'd seen it. And, yeah.
I mean, I think if you write something, you spend more time writing the piece than you actually spend on whatever happened. So the writing becomes more vivid and more real. And actually, I just was looking at some, I just came upon this absolutely accidentally today when I was looking through another book, and I found this, and which I cut out, which was by, this was in the New York Times in the Sunday Review section in 2013 by Andre Asiman. And he talks about how memoirists mold the truth. And I thought this was really good. I'm not a big fan of Andre Asiman's, but I thought this was really good. Writing the past is never a neutral act. Writing always asks the past to justify itself, to give its reasons, provided we can live with the reasons. What we want is a narrative, not a law, a tale, not a trial. This is why most people write memoirs using the conventions not of history, but of fiction. It's their revenge against facts that won't go away. Writing alters, reshuffles, intrudes on everything. The small things, a shifty adverb or an adjective with attitude, or just a trivial little comma is enough to reconfigure the past. And maybe this is why we write. We want a second chance. We want the other version of our life, the one that thrills us, the one that happened to the people we really are, not to those we just happen to be once.
That's great. Yeah. And it also is sort of analogous to the idea of the ghost, and it's almost like the hypothetical life, the life that could have been led, all the alternate lives that, and that's what you do with the Veronique is.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, and it's the process of selection, and how do you, I mean, like one thing you said to me that you wanted to do, one of the motivations was your family.
Right, right. I feel that I also, when I started out, I'm the last, my maiden name is Thompson, and I'm the last Thompson, you know, alive still. And my children and my grandchildren, they all know much, their family history is much more heavily weighed on their father's side and the father's family, which is much more accessible. They're from Cincinnati. So I wanted to create sort of a document, even if part of it is fictionalized, that was sort of solid for them, and that was like a book that you could put on a shelf.
And you created a sort of semi-created a lover for your mother, Claude, who was a real person.
Yeah.
And the handsome MacDuck,
yes.
What was he, a polo player?
No, he was. He was a pilot.
Pilot. Yeah.
Yeah.
And and you said, you said he was the love of your mother's life.
Yeah.
Like, I just felt so bad because I loved your father. Oh, thank you so much. And I want you to read maybe from the journal that you found of his. But he continued to love your mother, but
yes.
He had this very exotic, he was a producer in Rome, and he was producing Italian films, and you were having dinner with Magnani and all these stars. Of.
But I mean, typically, I started visiting my father when I was 9, and I didn't want to visit my father. I mean, actually, the book starts out with me flying to Rome by myself. I think I'm 8 or 9 years old, and the plane has engine trouble, and we're stuck in Gander for hours, and then it stops in Shannon, and Paris, and finally Rome. I mean, the trip takes forever and ever and ever. And then I wasn't particularly close to my father because he'd been gone during the war, and I was always a little bit frightened of him as well. I got obviously closer to him as time went on, but going to visit him was always a wrench. But then, and then led a very grown-up life. I mean, he always had mistresses, and each summer there was a different mistress, and I ended up becoming friends with the mistresses because I didn't have any other friends at all anymore. And the mistresses were all obviously nice to me because...
you didn't have any contemporary friends.
So I always ended up having dinner with my father's friends very, very late in Rome and being bored. And one night we actually had dinner with Miami, and I remember being horrified because she talked with her mouth full. So that's my impression of Miami. Her acting talent. So when I was in Rome as a child, I wanted to be with my mother and stepfather, who had a house in Maine in the summer, and I wanted to go sailing, canoeing, and playing tennis. But then when I got to Maine, I thought Maine was very boring, and I wanted to go back to Rome. So it was always, the grass is greener on the other side. And my father was not a sort of cozy person or very much in touch with his emotions. As I said, I was always a little bit frightened of him, and
he tried to do his best. I mean,
yes, absolutely.
It's hard for him too.
He didn't know what to do with his child.
And one of the things I like too, you really get not with so much with that part of your life, but with when your mother drove you to Spain, you took the nanny, and you sort of imagine her life and her sister's life, so they become characters too. It's not like just the servants and you, so they're part of the story.
I mean, I can't believe this, but we took, my mother took this young woman from Brittany, who was 19, and she went to Lima, Peru with us and spent 5 years in Peru, and probably was not in touch with her family during the entire war. And just kind of the arrogance of taking somebody, but I mean, I think her name was Jeanne. Jeanne probably didn't question it either.
No, she just thought. I'm questioning everything.
Yeah, she was the nurse, and she came with us. So, and then we completely lost touch with her, and no idea what's become of Jeanne.
And yet you were sort of close at the time.
Yeah.
It sounded like nurturing. So, your father's.
All right.
And how did you find these, by the way?
My father, I was lucky because my father kept this journal about his wartime experience, and I quote from it and use it. And then I also had a great grandfather who, also German from the Rhineland, who came to the United States in 1848. And he went to Mexico and to Texas where he sold shoddy cotton goods, and he made and lost a huge fortune. And he kept a journal as well, which I have, which my grandmother translated from the German for me. And actually, the journal is quite boring because he just talks a lot about how much all these goods cost and what he sold them for and stuff like that. But he had, I think, two run-ins with Indians, and that was sort of interesting. And for me, the most interesting part and the most sort of wonderful part was that on his way back to Germany in 1861, when his sort of business had come to a close because the Civil War was about to happen and the ports were shut, so he wouldn't be able to go back and forth. But on his way back to Germany, he stopped in Washington, D.C., and it turned out to be Inauguration Day, and he went into the White House and shook Abraham Lincoln's hand. I still have goose pimples talking about it because, I mean, and what did they say to each other? I mean, I sort of invent a little dialogue, but just how wonderful is that?
So then you're ended.
So anyway, I use that journal and my father's journal, which I'll read a little bit.
Did he give it to you?
He wrote it in French, and I actually translated it, and he wanted it. He wrote it for his grandchildren, my three sons, actually. And this is when, this part is when he was interned in the camp in France. And it was in a town called Mahol, which is very close to Blois, in the Loire Valley. And before that, he'd been interned in the Stade de Colombe, which was for 15 days, which is where the 1924 Olympic Games were. And that sounded just absolutely horrible because there was no sanitation and there were just hundreds and hundreds of people who were just stuck there for 15 days and they were all on bleachers and not allowed to move or anything. But anyway, here he is in Mahal. I awoke feeling quite gloomy. I told myself that if they'd forgotten about us at Cologne, here we were even farther away. The refugees were only a small problem for the French government, or perhaps not even a problem. And to have brought us so far must seem that we would stay here a long time, maybe for the entire duration of the war. My gloomy thoughts were interrupted by a young man who came up to me and asked, "Would you like 2 fried eggs for your breakfast?" I thought he was pulling my leg, and I answered him in kind, "Sure, with pleasure." 10 minutes later, I got those eggs. Simon Herbst, a little Pole who had nothing to do with the Germans except that his papers, due to a bureaucratic mix-up, said German national, was an egg merchant in Paris, as well as the most resourceful person I met during the entire war. Already, he knew everything there was to know about the village of Mahol, and he was always in a good mood and ready to help. He made my life in camp much easier. Unfortunately, he did not stay as resourceful to the bitter end. Simon Herbst was one of the 6 million who never came back.
But he also became a leader. He
was a bomb engineer.
I know, but didn't he become the head of the leader?
Yeah.
I mean, he actually, as you
he
say,
the
came into his own in some way.
The spokesperson.
Yeah. So lucky. Well, you know, I think it was part of the thing of being Jewish and during the war and not ever talking about it, just wanting to get away from it. I think it's just so hard for us to even grasp the mindset. And even the young woman coming with you, to have lived in so many different places, it must have been extremely hard when you first got here and you didn't speak, you'd never spoken English, right? You hadn't learned it yet. And so you were just thrown into it. And they didn't have special learning classes or anything like that.
I keep saying, when we arrived in New York, I was put into Nyingo Banford School in the 4th grade. I didn't speak a word of English. I didn't know what was going on or what anybody was saying. I knew they were studying the Egyptians because there were pictures of pyramids and hieroglyphs on the walls. But at the same time, there was no special ed or anything. I think the teacher just sort of ignored me because she was so embarrassed to have this sort of dolt in a class. And I ended up sort of not opening my mouth in English until I could speak English without an accent because I didn't want to be taken to be a foreigner. And my mother didn't mind. But
did you feel that was the kind of taboo against foreigners?
Right. I remember once when we first arrived, we got onto the Madison Avenue bus via the back door, because that's how you got on buses in Paris. And the bus driver stopped the bus, got out of the bus, yelled at us, and made us get off the bus screaming, you know, something about damn foreigners. So, that.
How did your mother handle this? Did she try to...
I don't think she was that aware of it.
Uh-huh.
Again, she was so beautiful.
Yeah. When you say that when the boat docked, you bring people in, you observe your own rules of chronology, right? I mean, that's one of the, I think, exciting things about it. You go back and forth in time so that, I mean, I think the whole, that idea of the instability is in the form, in a way, in the non-transition. But when does actually Gabby come in real chronology?
They married in 1938.
So she did know until soon.
Yeah.
She knew him. Yeah.
She'd met him before.
Yeah. And then that was a very sort of WASP, conventional WASP life in Maine and New York. Yeah. Well, another thing that I think fits in with the autofiction is that when you're going on that first momentous traumatic trip to visit your father, you pick up the charm in the gift shop. another thing where it's fiction, but maybe it isn't.
Right, right. I mean, again, I think, I mean, whatever I've invented not for the sake of invention, but because I feel that it's kind of real or true or it shows a truth of some kind. And most of the things that I invent, I'm not there or I don't remember or I have to sort of figure out, or I also have to make it more dramatic through some sort of invention. But I'm going to read something because another writer that I like so much is Carl Ove Noskar, and I just read the two of my struggles, but I think he explains what he does, and this is from an interview in The Guardian. He says, "For me, there has been no difference in remembering something and creating something. When I wrote my fictional novels, they always had a starting point of something real. Those images that are not real have exactly the same strength and power as the real ones, and the line between them is completely blurred." And I feel the same way, and it's, again, when you write something and you concentrate so hard on making it as good as you can, that becomes more real to you than the actual event.
And you also said something, and then we'll see if anybody has any questions or remarks, that you hope, I think it was in the essay on autofiction, I'm not sure, where you hoped your readers would read you with imagination. And but you're not spoon-feeding them a narrative, you're not just giving them the confession.
I mean, I think I've been accused of being a sort of minimalist. I don't describe anything.
Well, you were influenced by Gordon Lish, for
right,
one thing,
right?
You were one of his acolytes.
Yeah. But I don't describe what people look like or what color their hair is. And if it's important, I think it will somehow surface later. But basically, I like to keep it sort of not open-ended, but I like for the reader to not to do some work, but to sort of
meet you halfway. Yeah, and to not be passive.
Right.
And just one more thing that that Forbes said in that wonderful review. He said something about the weightlessness of the character, relative weightlessness of the character, which I love. There's something, because they're not anchored in all these details.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So maybe we'll throw it open and see if anyone has any questions. Sorry. Yes?
How did or why did you end up in Peru rather than staying in America?
Well, one, we didn't have a visa for America. And two, my father had a sister who married a Peruvian and lived in Lima. And so we got visas for Peru. Unfortunately, the Peruvians, the German Peruvians, were all very misguided, and they were all for Germany. So that created a very unpleasant atmosphere. But nevertheless, that was the reason. Yeah.
And you went from Peru to New York?
We went to Uruguay first. We went to Montevideo for a year, and then Paris, back to Paris.
Oh. Yes.
Did your mother ever speak to you about the trip over, or did you intuit everything that she described? For example, her reluctance to let you play with the 14-year-old.
Her reluctance to.
Well, did your mother talk to you about the trip, or is that an example of inventing what you think your mother must have thought?
Yeah, it's more of an example of inventing, yeah. I hate to point to what's invented and what's true, because it's all sort of mixed up together.
I just wondered if she had spoken about that trip to you ever.
Neither parents spoke very much about their past.
I mean, you and your mother never reminisced about the trip?
No. My mother, she didn't want to have anything to do with Germany. I mean, she didn't say she was German. She kept saying that she was from Europe. My father refused to ride in a Mercedes car. I mean,
and nobody.
You just wanted to close the book on that, yeah.
And here, so different. Is that why you wrote the book?
Well, because I wanted my children to know about my family also. And also, I mean, until I really researched this book, yes, I knew that my family was Jewish, but again, people didn't talk about that either because both my parents had become Lutherans. They were assimilated. And if it hadn't been for Hitler, you know, nobody would have said that we were Jewish.
It would have been an issue.
Yeah, exactly.
One of your ancestors was a great Felix.
Yeah,
was
Moses.
Moses Mendelssohn.
Yes, yeah. So I learned a lot about my family writing this book, which was nice. Yeah. I had a good time writing this book, which
somebody back here.
Max Sebald's writing style reflected in your.
I think so. Yeah, I hope so. I hope so.
And the pictures.
Yes,
the
pictures.
I love this. I was looking at these, and because, well, my favorite one is the one on the back, which is so grumpy looking.
This was my passport picture when I came to the United States. Yeah. Did not look happy.
And so, sort of overnight, you sort of indicate this, that you overnight, because you were sort of like, you know, adolescence came and you suddenly slimmed down. And I there was this picture, and I said, who is that? I thought it was one of the movies, one of the stars in one of your father's films. It's like this pinup, and that's her. From this to that.
And to this now. British relatives who very kindly sent me a lot of stuff. And I also feel slightly guilty because I have a first cousin, the daughter of my mother's sister, lived in Tanzania, and I don't know her very well. Her name is Irene, and I wrote her and said, can you send me any sort of facts or things that you remember about your life in Tanzania with your parents? I'm writing a family history. And so she very kindly sent me things, and it wasn't particularly interesting, except for one item where she said her mother was having breakfast on their terrace in the plantation, the size of the plantation, and she was sitting on a cushion, and under the cushion was a nest of cobra eggs. So of course I use that because I'm sort of a magpie and I love those kind of details. But then I sent her the book, and then I was very nervous because I made up stuff about her parents and everything. And I thought she would be horribly offended. But instead, just 2 or 3 days ago, she wrote a very nice email saying that she enjoyed reading the book and that she also learned a lot about the family. So that was
and just that she didn't care if it was fact either.
So that was very nice. Yeah.
Where does the book end? And you said it began with the first book in Rome.
Yes.
What's the shape from the beginning and the end?
Yeah. I mean, it ends with another voyage. I go, Liliane goes to Thailand.
Well, you're in Paul DeMann's class at Harvard.
Yeah.
That's kind of the age you are at there.
Right.
And then you quote him about Bruce.
And yeah.
Then
and then I take another plane
and
go to Thailand, which I in fact did.
And you were how old?
Well, then I was 22, 21. Yeah.
But you are an adventurer. I mean, when your mom, the passage about your mother just getting in the car and driving to Spain, I mean, that's just cute. I mean, you get in the car and drive to Maine any old time or any. No, but it's not. Not Maine, but I mean other places too. You are an adventurer. You are. Thailand. I mean, that was a pretty bold thing to do. Yeah. To meet this guy, you didn't know what was going to happen. Yeah. Nancy?
I think it's an absolutely wonderful book, but I have a tiny complaint.
Uh-oh.
Which reflects.
I
know. Well, tiny complaint reflects my life as a journalist, and I'm sure it plays into your approach to this writing, which is not to have captions on the pictures.
insist on having picture captions, and most of the pictures in the book you can figure out pretty much, but a few of them I really would like to have had identities, but I know this doesn't play into the whole idea of
too much spelling out.
I feel the same way though. I wanted to know too. I mean, like Claude is in there, and I want.
So which one is Claude?
Yeah, well, you told me, but
yeah.
I didn't.
Yeah. I don't know. I just wanted that
the mystery.
Mystery.
Yeah.
Yeah. And Seabold didn't.
Yes, I knew you were going to say that.
In his footsteps.
Him and Nausgaard will give you credentials for anything you do.
I just think it's an absolutely extraordinary book, and I just was completely thrilled by it. With all the literary decisions that you made were so perfect. I don't know how you discovered the form. Did you struggle with the form, or did it just come to you? Did you just? It seems. Incredibly sure, you know, the tone, the shape, everything about it. I mean, I really am so impressed and so full of admiration.
Thank you.
But I think structurally it's just amazing. I think you're a very great literary technician in addition to everything.
I didn't pay that much attention to the structure. I mean, I moved some chapters around at some point, but basically.
Cut a few things, like you had a lot of information about airplanes at one time.
I did.
Yeah. I thought you knew too much about airplanes. That was my only cruise. But it was very technical. Because you love doing research.
Right.
Like you had your character, a physicist, in your life book.
Yeah.
And you had a good time. Do you remember, can you tell us what you learned about physics?
No, not that.
Can I just say one more thing? Interested in dry technicalities. I think it's incredibly, it has a wonderful sort of seductive thread running through it. And I think the way that you, because apart from everything else, it's about the sexual awakening of a young girl, which is, I think you just do so beautifully, you know, the strangeness and the mystery of these things that happened to her and her curiosity. In all of that, she's very French as well, somehow. She's surrounded
and
by...
And sort of non-judgmental, too.
And yes,
yeah.
But it has a wonderful, it has many things, but it has this rather sort of savory song sort of atmosphere that I found very, very intriguing.
Thank you so much.
There's any parallel between combining fact and fantasy and auto-fiction and unconscious plagiarism, which is something I have to guard against all the time.
Well, that's what Sachs talks about in that same essay.
Uh-huh.
He talks about auto-plagiarism. He uses that term. I don't know if he coined it or what, but yes. He says he doesn't know whether it's an unconscious thing, whether he just forgot that he said something before or what. But I think that is very, don't you think that's a very real...
Yeah, I mean, I use... things that I've written before in this, and I was very nervous that somebody would sort of...
Did you rewrite them?
I rewrote some, but not everything. Because
you did a short story about the grandfather.
Right,
yeah.
I used that, and then I write about Alberto Moravia, and I wrote a story. I used that in the Elsa Morante book. So I bowdlerized myself. and I was worried that somebody would call me on that, but since it's my work,
that would be sort of flattering that they remembered it, I think. That wouldn't be so bad.
but I think I was careful to sort of acknowledge pretty much everybody that I use. I hope,
I'm just curious about if your children are writers.
My children, they're not. Well, my eldest son is a screenwriter.
The title, The Double Life, suggests that there was an acting out of two different personas, but I found a sort of constant mode on, sort of who was able to navigate the two cultures very, very incomprehensible.
But I think in the Paul DeMann class that I took, he makes a difference between the writing eye and the written eye, and I think that's the sort of important thing in the end. And I came on this sort of by accident at the very end. When you're writing the eye, it's very different from the written eye. And I think that creates a double life.
Well, you know, you did a very interesting essay that I don't think you published, but about being in fact, it's sort of your emergence with a sense of authority as a person, actually, but it might have fed into the writing too, when you were with your husband who had always bossed you around, and you'd been a sort of the conventional wife, and then you were in Paris, and suddenly you were speaking French.
And he couldn't speak French.
And you couldn't speak French.
And
but
was
just
so happy.
Talk about it a little bit, because that was an important moment, I think.
I don't know.
That was really interesting that suddenly you came to do your own in French in a way that you hadn't in English.
Right.
So, I mean.
But I also feel that I'm slightly different when I speak French. I speak French on a much more authoritative, because I feel that French people are very energetic and they're always arguing.